So hello everyone and happy Friday to you. Sorry I missed last Friday. I had planned to get on, but everything just ran together and I didn't get that together. So if you're new, welcome. What we're doing here is talking about information relevant to basic backyard beekeeping, small scale beekeeping. And the questions that we're going to talk about today are down in the video description down below. And these were questions that were submitted now over the last 2 weeks because, as I said, I didn't get to it last week. Also, some people are waiting to see my results on the wrap around feeder problems and solutions, and that is done now. I decided to extend those observations another week because we want to make sure and put out solid information. So those are out in the apiary right now with a lot of different configurations, and the results are in. Those are done. So that video will be edited this weekend and posted this weekend. So that's the other end of that. Also, make sure to click the like button down here below so you'll know that you've watched episode number 63. And we're going to jump right into it, I think. I have nothing else to talk about ahead of time. Other than that, the weather's really warm and I can't wait to get out there. We've got thunderstorms coming. And if you're in the northeastern United States or any part of the United States right now, and if you have not yet planted your bee plants for the year, this is the weekend. This is the time. So get ready, get out there and do it, and then plant, and then all these rainstorms are coming tomorrow and they will water in your seeds for you. So that's good to go. Let's get right into this. The first one comes from Emmanuel Butmankevich. Fred, have you done any videos on wax moths? I just installed my two nukes on Tuesday, and when I checked my flow hive bottom drawer, there were little black pellets of poop the thickness of pencil lead. I posted on Facebook and some suggested wax moth larva. Others said cockroach. Another said earwig. I wasn't planning to do my first hive inspection until Sunday. Okay, well, where were the... Those could be anything, but they could be wax moths. They could be the wax worms discharging. But here's the thing. If you've got a solid population in that hive, you probably don't really have a big problem. The other thing is we're talking about the collection tray that's underneath, that is through the integrated pest management aluminum bottom board. So it's already down in that tray. The other thing is, if your tray is dry, I highly recommend that you put mineral oil or cooking oil in there. I use mineral oil in it because I like to get pictures of stuff if I find something cool. If you put cooking oil in there, it's going to tint it all yellow and it's kind of going to get a little hazy. And so I recommend mineral oil in the trays and look it over. The other thing is, you haven't done your inspection yet. I think you're going to find out your inspection will reveal what's really going on. Because if you have waxworms already, this is, two nukes on Tuesday. So if we already have these problems, they came with your nukes. So they came, a nuke is a nucleus colony of bees, for those of you who are new, and should be 3 to 5 frames of them. So if they're in there now, my suspicion is that they came with them. The good news is what you're finding, though, is down in the tray. The rest you're going to find out from inspection. Let's say that they're wax worms. If they're wax worms, a strong colony of bees are going to keep those wax worms out. In fact, as they start to develop, they'll pull them right out and get rid of them. So as far as what the little bits of scat are, that's anybody's guess, but you're going to find out when you do the inspection. So what can you do right now? Make sure the tray has mineral oil or something else, so when something does drop through, it dies. And for those of you who have new packages that you've just installed, or if you're right now, most people are going into their, it's been 3.5 weeks since they installed packages and stuff, so they should be having a really good buildup right now because we're past the 21-day mark. So if you've got a pest load, small hive beetles, larvae, you know, if you've got pests like varroa destructor already showing up, make sure to let the seller know that your package came loaded with parasites. That's very important. And if I were selling packaged bees, I would want that feedback right away because I want to know what's going on in my apiary. So next we're going to move on. This is from Michael Haldeman. I'm a new beekeeper this year and installed 2 hives. After about a month, the hives were off to a good start and I decided to do a mite away treatment just in case. And my bees came with, just in case my bees came with mites. After the treatment, I noticed a very small number of mites on the bottom boards. What was concerning is that one of the boards, there were at least a dozen small hive beetle larvae crawling around on the bottom board. I had previously only seen one small hive beetle in the hive and immediately squashed it, placed out traps and laid down diatomaceous earth under the hive. I have removed the larvae and killed them. Should I be concerned about this? And is there anything I should do now? Now this goes right back. Here's another one. This is a brand new package install here. So when your bees are new and they come preloaded, especially if you're a brand new beekeeper and you don't already have bees in your bee yard, where are they coming from? They had to come with the packages that you purchased. So the other thing is we already also saw we've got small hive beetle larvae. So that means that they're in your comb, in the honeycomb. And the other thing is you've got varroa destructor mites already. So if those are the only colonies that you own and you just got them, they came with your bees. So make sure to contact the person that you got them from. The other thing, when it comes to small hive beetles, I try to test small hive beetle traps every year. So we're going to go over that a little bit, because you can't fail by having a trap in there. If you don't have beetles, good for you. If they happen to be there and you're just not seeing them, because they do hide out, they're dodging the bees. In general, the bees don't like them, even though there's that viral video that shows the bees actually feeding the small hive beetles. That is not the case in every bee line. So these are called beetle jails. These things are dirt cheap. In fact, they're so cheap, they're like disposable. But this hangs over the frame inside your hive up to one of the sides and to the back, hopefully. Why? Because that's where the small hive beetles run to avoid the bees. So the cool thing about beetle jails, I don't know these people. I get nothing for talking about their stuff. But in the middle of this is where you want to put bits of pollen because they're attracted to it. If you've got ultra bee dry pollen sub laying around that's left over from spring, put that in here. And then what happens is it's got this little top on it that you can close. So now it's in there and the small hive beetles will smell it and they're going to try to get to it. So then what happens? You close this other piece over the top and look, there's these little openings in it. And your small hive beetles will run across the top of the frame trying to get, number one, away from the bees. Or number two, if the bees are clustered at night, like when it's cold and the beetles are roaming around taking advantage of that, they'll smell that and they'll go down into these little slits. And then in these little reservoirs, you will have mineral oil or cooking oil. Some people put shortening in there, whatever you want to do. You know, that stuff apparently also is attractive to the beetles. But anyway, then you get beetles in your beetle jail and you can pull them out. So it's part of a pest management, pest trapping program. If you have these and these have worked for you, share down in the video comment section and tell us how they work or how you're dealing with your small hive beetles. I'm in the northeastern United States. Some people up here do have problems with small hive beetles. I've seen like one last year when I was trying to test how to trap them. Didn't have any. One adult beetle. So their cycle is that once they reproduce in a very disgusting way in your honey super, because they reproduce in the honeycomb, and then their slimy little larvae get out and they depart the hive and they go into the ground around it. So notice here that they said they put diatomaceous earth around the hives. I don't know how effective that is against the larvae, the beetle larvae that are going to get into the soil and then they're going to pupate. Those who have free-ranging chickens, as I do, have some defense too, because the chickens run around and scratch up little beetle larvae and things like that if they find them. Voles, shrews, moles also eat them. So if you've got moles and voles around your apiary also, you've got some type of control. But what we want to prevent is them getting back into the hive. Now they crawl out and fall out as larvae when they go into the soil. How do they get back in the hive? Well, you're not going to do anything to set up a barrier for that, because they're going to fly in. Because by the time they pupate, they emerge as adults, they can fly. And their whole purpose then is to consume and reproduce. And that's what they're doing to your honey. So if you've ever seen someone's honeycomb and it's been slimed out by beetles, that is one disgusting looking thing. And I hope it never happens to me. And apparently once they start that, the bees don't do anything with that honey either. So it's not something the bees are good at cleaning out. So if you've got slimed out small hive beetle honey supers, honey frames, you got to pull them out and power wash them and dip them in bleach and everything else and get that under control. But my recommendation for this is strong population and hives that are not oversized. This is something too that some new people often do, is that they're so anxious to expand their hives. So you've got your brood box, which is where you started, your package, your nucleus, whatever you've begun with. And then the second box goes on, and then they're just barely getting started. So then you get excited, you put another box on. But if the population in that hive is not big enough to really police, clean, and maintain and defend that physical space that you've provided for them, you're inviting an opportunity for things like small hive beetles to get in and to set up house. Another check that you want to do is if you've got some kind of feeder boards on there, and maybe there's little openings in it, but the bees can't get up into your feeder space, you need to make sure that there are no hiding places up there for small hive beetles. That's why in my feeder shims, I have really fine screens for the venting, which the bees plug up anyway. The other thing is, and we're going to talk about these in a minute too, these wrap-around feeders that sit over the hole, sit flush on the bottom, so there's no room for beetles and things like that to move in and out through there to hide out. So look for hiding places. Normally your bees will gum those up with propolis themselves. But so those are all the steps that you can take to deal with the small hive beetles, which I hope never to get, even though it means I can't share with you exactly what they're doing. So here's another frequent viewer of yours. A while ago I watched you switch from landing board feeders to wrapped around feeders. And I placed an order on Amazon at the links you provided in your YouTube. And I got an email from YouTube that you posted a video this past Friday. And much to my surprise, it was about the product I had just placed an order for based on your recommendation. And I watched your video and was dismayed to learn that I would probably receive faulty feeders. And this is from John Lowe of Clearwater, Florida. I'm going to make a long story short here and let you know that, yeah, I made this kind of emergency video because what happened was we got crappy wrap-around feeders. And what I realized was they were not all made the same, and this little central cone here was actually sitting too low, or that center riser was too tall. Whatever the combination was, the bees cannot get over that center cone and then access the sugar syrup. So you ended up with full feeders that were never going down because the bees couldn't get to them. And then of course I had to get on Amazon because I wrote a review on there about how much I like the wrap-around feeders. And then I complained about how they had become modified, how they weren't what they used to be. This is one of the original ones, and notice how it sticks down here at the bottom. Well, they didn't do that anymore. So I figured they must have changed sources. They must be getting their wrap-around feeders from some garbage supplier. So here I am recommending a specific seller on Amazon. Rocket Hardware is the seller's name. And so then I went in there and I chicken slammed them, saying that some of the products they're getting are not the quality that they used to be. And then because I want to be thorough, what did I do? I placed another order for a bunch of their feeders because I want to see if they're faulty. And guess what happened? This is the new feeder that came, and it is the exact same link. And look, this one, actually, they actually claim it with a label. And I also noticed where this one is the original that I liked so much. And then there's the cheap, crappy ones that came later that I had to shim. This is the one that, notice it doesn't protrude through the bottom, but it was kind of flimsy. And look what's in this one. Yep, it's full of sponges, because that's part of the testing that we're doing. And like I said, those videos are done. I'm going to share with you. I'm going to upload those videos tonight, maybe tomorrow at the latest. But what I'm impressed by is the new feeders that are coming are much better now than even the originals were. The material's thicker. It's more rigid. This piece feels better. Not only that, it holds its position. Look at this thing. Tip it sideways. It's holding its position in there. The original ones that I still like, they would fall off during that. And you're going to think, ah, Fred, you over-tilted that to make your point. Okay, let's go vertical. Let's just go. Look, it's already fallen out. Uh-huh. The new ones are better. Now, do you think that company goes, oh, no, it's Fred. He's not happy. Let's make a whole new batch and get those out to him. No, they didn't have time to do that. So the tops are thicker. These are also, with some of the other ones, the top boards were a little flimsy, and they bend every which way. Look at this thing. I wonder if you can see how the light even passes through it. So the differences, even in the material thicknesses, has improved. The other thing is, these, they don't put their names on these. So I would like to believe they have changed their source. And guess what it comes in? These crappy ones that I was complaining about that didn't fit right came in a transparent plastic bag. That's it. And they were just thrown in boxes and they came from Amazon. Look where they come in now. This one's unopened. That's exactly how it came. Solid boxes now. Better materials. There's no flexing in this cover, and it's a little bit convex, which is what I'd really like to see. I would love to see these a little more domed even than they are now. Why is that? So when condensation builds up, when in the wintertime you're doing dry sugar in these, if this was a domed top, then when condensation comes through the chimney, because the condensation comes from your bees and the respiration, and then it collects up here, then the little droplets would go down here on the sides, and then it would drop down onto your dried sugar, which is your winter emergency feed. But I'm happy. Let me just make a long story short. Like I said, I bought a whole box of these, and much better material. So now I'm confident. I'm still going to provide a link to these now to the same group, Rocket Hardware, on Amazon. I'm not hating them as much as I was a week ago. And again, I get no kickbacks from them. I'm not, you know, they don't write me. I couldn't even find a contact person. And I tried because I wanted to write them and let them know that, dude, your rabbit around feeders are going downhill. So the principle, the configuration is the same when you get these wrapped around feeders from a bunch of different sellers. But right now, I'm going to say that the best quality one is, it's marked Apis, which we all know is Apis mellifera anyway. But they've improved. So I don't know if they found a different source. Probably. I don't think they make them themselves. So they must be buying and reselling. And those are good. Those are solid. So I like them. So yes, I had to own up to the fact that I was leading people down a path to some cheap garbage that wasn't working. So the bottom line too is, make sure you can physically see even when you grab this, how see how flimsy the edges are? And this is the one I liked originally, so the new ones are better. Anyway, make sure that you can see your bees getting over the top and getting in there. The other thing is, do you know why they drown mostly? I'm going to talk about this a little bit right now, even though I'm going to talk about it again. When your levels get low in these rapid round feeders, and first of all, your hive has to be perfectly level. So none of this tilting to the sides, all these drunken beehives will have a problem when you have a feeder that has an open surface effect like that. So you want to keep these as full as you can. I know that's inconvenient for some people. So I just put out another video too, that there's a 1 gallon in hive feeder from Bee Smart Designs that just came out. So if you want to look at that, that has zero spill factor and nothing can drown in it. But I found that most of the drowning happens when your bees can get down to the bottom once this is empty. And they're so desperate for those last few remnants of sugar down there that they actually start squeezing through underneath. And if there's a bunch of bees doing that, they could drown in the leftover syrup. The other thing is, all the surface area here, when the bees are really hungry for sugar syrup, they all pile up over the side. Now, if your sugar syrup is up nice and high and they hit the drink right here, they're being pushed in by their fellow bees. So this is actually a run on bees. It's kind of like in those old westerns when they were doing a cattle drive and then they'd see a water hole and they try to keep their cattle from stampeding to the water hole. These bees are stampeding to the sugar syrup and they're actually trying to get into it so desperately that they're pushing each other down into the syrup. So that's what we have to take care of when it comes to a design like this. Any of the ceracell feeders and stuff, people are also reporting that they've got problems with the corners on those. And I have another message here from another person that was afraid the ceracell was plugged up. But it's the same thing. As the syrup gets lower, you have more bees trying to cling down here, and then you have more bees behind them pushing in, trying to access the syrup. So they're actually pushing each other into the syrup and drowning one another. So you can cut way down on that by keeping your syrup routinely filled up. So that's the other part of it. Here we go. This is from Noah Ziegart, outside of San Francisco. I'm in Spain right now, going back home at June 28th. Would it be okay to get bees when I get back? I live in California, and my beehive would be next to a creek. The coldest it gets is 35 at winter. So that's the other thing. It's common for a lot of people that are just getting into this year, and they see somebody, well, they just set up a beehive. That looks cool. Can I get bees too? Well, you know, the rules are kind of the same for with a swarm. So when you're collecting swarms, we like to do that at a time when there are chances of making it to winter time. are the best. So these are the phrases. A swarm in May is worth a load of hay. A swarm in June is worth a silver spoon. A swarm in July, they say, let them fly. Now me, I collect swarms at any time. But May and June, if you're just starting out with your bees in May or June, generally your chances are really good. So I would say to Noah here, yeah, you can start. You're coming back in June. Of course, make sure everything is all set up and ready to go. Get a friend that can set your equipment up and source your bees, because that's the other thing. People are looking for bees. Every beekeeper is putting the word out. If you find a swarm, I'm happy to come and get it for you. That kind of thing. So there'll be competition for bees. So you want to make sure to secure your order of bees and make friends with beekeepers. Because a lot of beekeepers, like me, you get a swarm. You don't necessarily have room for the swarm in your own apiary. I don't want any more. So what I do is I get the swarms and help somebody else start out. So, give you an example. 2 days ago, I think it was 2 days ago, somebody said they found a swarm of bees on a tree branch deep in the woods down by a river. So, I don't need those bees, but here's the thing. Listen to what's being described. They're hanging on a tree branch deep in the woods down by a river. And this is in an area where there isn't an immediate beekeeper. So there's a very good chance that what we might get out of that, first of all, it's a prime swarm. It's happening in May. So this might be the first swarm that gets pushed out from a colony that survived what? Survived winter. So now we're talking about locally adapted bees. And they're free. All you have to do is go get them. And it turned out we showed up there and I was going to get these for my son. So because he wanted to start with bees, and I was making him study up and told him to wait and everything else. But then I thought, well, if we can get this swarm, now I can set up a satellite apiary at his house. He's like 15 miles away. And we'll do it with feral bees. So we go down there and it turns out we get on ATVs. We go down these trails. We go down through the woods. Pretty rough riding. So if you're bringing a swarm box, you know, not the best thing ever. But what do I catch my swarms with? I catch them with a butterfly net. And it's not normal butterfly net material. It's heavy muslin cloth, like a heavy-duty pillowcase. So I highly recommend this method. Get one of those really solid bass nets that have the aluminum frame. They're designed to pull up a 25-pound bass. I don't know if there is a 25-pound bass. I'm not a fisherman. Anyway, but it handles heavy fish, so it could probably, big catfish, let's say. We know those get big. Anyway, so if it's strong enough for that, it's strong enough for a big swarm of bees. Plus, you can make your own cloth. So you take the net off that comes with it, throw that away, but you make your own muslin cloth, a nice long one, and then you can shake your swarm into that, twist it around like a snake bag, flip it over your shoulder, and hike back out of there with your bundle of bees. Because the whole bag, they can breathe through. So there's none of these venting problems and stuff. So anyway, long story short, we went down there and got in there, and I brought my nippers with me. Always bring all the stuff that you need. Sprayed them a little bit with sugar water, and the guy that had found them while he was hiking and exploring in the woods, he held the branch down a little bit for me and held it very still so I could just carefully clip everything off. And we got a good 5 pounds of bees. They were all tight because it was early in the morning. That's the other thing. When you go after a swarm, get out there as early in the morning as you can. If they're bivouacked somewhere because it's gotten cold through the night, so what do? They create this really tight pack. What else are they not doing at that time of day? They're not scouting for a new location yet. So if you did that at 2 or 3 in the afternoon on a sunny, hot day, then the scouts are all out. There might be hundreds or even 1,000 scouts out looking for a new place to live. But if you get them right after sunrise, you get them early in the morning, it's still cool and it's damp and everything, you get all of them because the scouts aren't out yet. See? It's a clean collect and walk away. It didn't take 10 minutes to collect that swarm. And now, our son is a beekeeper. See how easy that is? So anyway, this is a great time of year to start with beekeeping. May or June, sure. And if you can get swarms, start right off with them. You're going to have to put a hive top sugar syrup feeder on to help them out, because this is a challenge for them. What is every colony of bees trying to do this time of year? They're trying to build up their numbers, bring in as many resources as they can. Today, they are already trying to prepare for the coming winter. Kind of sad, but that's what they're doing. Also, this time of year is the biggest time for the workforce to build up. So when you get a package or you get a swarm of bees, make sure to feed them, because a lot of people are asking, well, how long should I keep that feed on right now? Well, here's the rule. We don't want to feed sugar water to bees that are going to be, that we're going to harvest honey from. But when you've installed a package or a swarm this year, that's not your honey harvest group. All you're trying to do is help them build up. So if the frames inside that hive are just foundations, or if it's foundationless, then the bulk of their resources, the bulk of their energy is going to be in producing comb first, so the queen has somewhere to lay. But if you put something in there like better comb that's already drawn out, or you've got comb from other hives that you saved back from a surplus from last year, the more honeycomb you can provide for them, the faster they're going to build up, because the quicker the queen's going to be able to lay. And those workers who would be spending their energy building comb are now spending their energy instead flying out and foraging for pollen and nectar. So provide the sugar syrup they need when the weather gets cold to keep them going. And the more comb you can provide, the more you're going to accelerate their success this year. So that was a long way around the barn, but for Noah, who's outside of San Francisco, yes, you can start bees this year. I would do it. I install swarms all the way into September, especially now that we have all the drawn comb. They made it. Made it through winter. So happy right now. Anyway, the next one comes from Jay Patrick. That's Wego, New York. I have a question about single versus double brood boxes. I thought in one of your videos you stated you use doubles to help your bees make it through winter. Yes, I do. However, in one of your Friday questions videos, you mentioned that you would recommend expanding to a medium super. What are in a very similar climate? We are in a very similar climate as you, and right on Lake Ontario, my hives are getting ready for another box, and I want to do what gives the bees the best chance for surviving winter. So that is my rule of thumb. I always have at least two boxes just for the bees. Now, are they two deeps? Are they a deep and a medium? What are they? Rarely. I used to do two deeps, always. And then I came back on that, and I just went with a deep and a medium, which last winter was almost a complete disaster for me. So I'm going to show you this little drawing here. These are your choices. You can use two deeps or a deep and a medium. And why would you do that? Because that is just for the bees. That is not for you. So why would you do two deeps? So one of the things some of the people like to do in the spring is through the winter time, the bees are moving vertically up through your hive, and they're going to end up clustered at the very top. And when they come out of spring, that's where they're going to start laying. They're going to start moving back down. So in the springtime, let's say you had two deep brood boxes. One of the things that you can do, if they're all confined in that second box up, is now you can rotate them. You pull the bottom box out, put the top box down on the bottom board, and then you take that box, which has all the strong comb, all these resources that they've already used up, put it right back on top of that. Now what do you have? The cluster down here, and you've got comb and drawn out frames ready for them to expand right into. So because they're both deeps, doesn't matter. Now, if you've got a medium and a deep, my practice is to leave the medium on top. And of course, it takes more time because we have to wait for them to start to fill up with honey. And then they'll gradually migrate down, and the brood nest will go down as the temperatures raise in the spring. So there can be some delay there. The other thing is that improves your queen's habit of laying closer to the bottom of those frames is the addition of a slatted rack underneath, creating more airspace there. And then having that blockout board, that's a slatted rack right back there. And it goes, here's your bottom board, slatted rack goes on that, deep box, medium super. Then as the spring comes, they naturally migrate back down, and they're filling up all those extra frames, all those extra cells with now the new spring nectar flow. So that's my reasoning behind, but yes, I always recommend two boxes. The only hives that I have that go through winter with a single box are the late season swarms, and they have to really be handheld through winter, and most people say that they're going to die. I expected to lose five of them this year, and only one did not make it. All the rest of them did great. And the one that didn't make it, by the way, was a volunteer swarm that moved into a stored box. It wasn't even one that I installed myself. So they were just freebies. They were tiny. And they shared their winter space with mice, too. Deer mice went right in there. Next comes from Steve Kleinman. One person in my local bee association was asked about appropriate plants to add to their garden for their girls. Someone made a comment about how a particular recommended plant was ignored by their bees. Might it be possible that bees have a certain radius around their hive from which they will not harvest? It would make sense to me in a way. A hive might be less at risk of robbing if there are easier sources of nectar nearby. I have had a couple of plants in bloom that attracted solitary bees, but no honeybees. These plants are within 75 feet of the hive. What are your thoughts and experiences in this matter? That's a really good question, and it comes up a lot. And I already know what the answer is. Here's what happens. First of all, the honeybees will go after plants that are even right next to the hive, growing on the hive if you've got vines and things like that, and you ignore everything. So there is no set minimum radius that they'll fly to get resources for their hive, because bees want convenience and they want exactly what they need to feed their brood and to grow. Because what are they after? Well, they're after pollen and they're after nectar. No plant is producing nectar without producing pollen. Why? Because nothing's free. And the plant wants that bee to come so that bee can be a go-between between this plant and the other flower over there that it loves so much that it wants to use this bee to spread its seed and reproduce with that other plant over there. So, why aren't the bees coming to some of these plants when people find out, oh, this plant works really good, I'm going to plant those in my yard. Oh, this plant works really good, I'm going to plant these in a window box. Things like that. Bees, and the comment here too was that the solitary bees, the native pollinators, were coming to the plants, just not the honeybees. That's because native pollinators do not practice floral constancy. What the heck is that? Well, when the honeybees go out and they're foragers, and this is a senior job in the hive, so once they're leaving, they're rough and tough and they're ready to take on the world. And when they go out to forage, a bee that goes and lands on a dandelion, let's say, only goes to dandelions. So that bee flies from this dandelion to this dandelion to this dandelion. Oh, there's clover over here. Do you think that bee will go from dandelion to clover? No, because floral constancy means that the honeybee only gets nectar and pollen from a single plant species at a time. So then when that goes in, now here's the thing. We already know, how do bees decide what plants to go after? Well, first of all, they shotgun out, all the foragers go everywhere. How far do they go? They go miles and miles if they need to. But does that mean that they will go miles and miles? No, because they may not need to. If the source is local, if the source is 100 feet away, they're going to it. A good example of that would be that if you put out sugar syrup 20 feet from your hive and they all dive on it and start taking in the sugar syrup, that tells you right there, they're going to go after a local resource because they want that nectar. They want the sugar syrup. So here's the thing. You have to have enough of the flower that you're trying to attract them to. So you need a high density of this flower. So for example, if you have a garden, and I know people, even people with tropical fish tanks do this. I want every kind of fish in my tank because I want all these pretty fish in there. So now you have a community tank. People are very similar when they're looking at putting up a garden for the way it looks. They want things that appeal to the bees, but they also want things that appeal to people. And variety is the spice of life, as they say. So they put up a few plants of bee balm, and then we've got some daisies, and then we've got, you know, some other plants that the bees will go after. But you would attract more bees if you did nothing but bee balm. So if you created an entire quarter acre yard of nothing but bee balm, it's going to be buzzing with bees, and the honeybees will go after that too, but the honeybees will go after like clover. So if you get a whole yard full of clover, now it's worth it for the bees to come back, do a waggle dance. What kind of information do bees communicate when they waggle dance and they get into the hive and they get on the dance floor? There's a specific area inside your beehive that gets used over and over. This is like the communication frame, and it's usually down in the brood box. It's near the brood. And over here is where all the waggling happens. Okay, so a bee flies in, it's got pollen on its legs, and it's got nectar. So it lands here, and it gets met by other bees who taste test the nectar. And this bee is advertising the products that they're bringing in. And so if they waggle a little bit and they seem half-hearted, they do a few cycles of waggling, you know, they waggle, they turn to the right, they waggle a little bit, they turn to the left, and they're communicating where the source is. If there's not a lot of what they've brought with them, the waggling doesn't last very long. And the cycles, the number of times they repeat their dance, doesn't go on for very long. Now, if the source that they found is very good and there's a lot of it, then they're more vigorous and energetic about the communication on this dance floor and how many cycles they do communicating that stuff, saying, there's a lot of it, I'm not kidding, there's piles of it, it's more than you could ever handle. They keep waggling, keep moving, until you see two or three bees with their antenna on it and they're moving with it and they're checking it out, they're going back and forth, and another one comes in right behind it with same information, went to the same type of plants. So they already know. When they're taste testing it and everything, they know what the pheromone, they know what the plant's going to smell like. They know through the waggle dance geographically where it's located. And they know through the energy level of the bee that's delivering the information how much of it is there. So if you've got three of a variety of flowers in your yard, but half a mile away, there's a quarter acre of that flower, you're going to get very little interest in your location. Whoever's got the abundance and the concentration of that source is going to get most of the attention. So, and I'm going to do a quick rundown here too on which plants, by the way. So in the spring, and by the way, I just did a t-shirt that says, the more you know, the less you mow. And it should show up underneath this video, Teespring. So I have a Teespring storefront. It says, the more you know, the less you mow. And it's got a honeybee hovering over a dandelion. Because dandelions, by the way, have they're finished. They've already gone by here. But by leaving them tall, every 3 feet, there were bees on dandelions out here. So we know that they were using them. So early in the spring, the things that you can provide for your bees are the dandelions, of course. The next thing that comes out are the fruit trees. So we even missed, by the way, the weather got really bad, and my cherry trees got almost no visits because it dropped down into the 40s and low 50s, and we had overcast days. So they got half the pollination attention they should have had. So apple trees and everything are coming in right now. Now, would a bunch of bees go to those apple trees? Yes, because there's 13 apple trees out there. So that's enough to get their attention. It's a concentration of a single source. And then, of course, clover's going to kick in. And clover, white clover in particular, is going to carry the bees right through summer. So there again, try to convince people to set their mowers at like 5 inches or 4 inches. You know, your grass is more drought tolerant anyway. The taller the grass blades are, the deeper the roots are, and the healthier the plants are. And don't let people make you get the beneficial weeds out of your yard. So then the clover is the broad span. It's going to go right through summer. So we get clover honey right along, and that stuff is so light colored, and it is great honey. So if we get a spring honey that you could take off, it would be from clover. The next one that kicks in is going to be the American linden trees. L-I-N-D-E-N. Mature linden trees have huge amounts of nectar on them. And the next one that comes in, pretty much there's two plants for me that come in at the same time. The milkweeds start blooming, and that has a sustained period of bloom and a sustained provision of nectar for your bees. Although I personally wouldn't be able to pick out, milkweed honey, if that exists, if that's a thing. The other thing is sunflowers. So we want to keep the pollen resources coming in. And so I have a wide variety of sunflowers, and we're talking acres of them. So they're going to be loaded. But they don't get as much attention as all the clover does. So the bees, given the options, prefer clover to sunflowers. But what do the sunflowers provide? Huge loads of pollen for rearing baby bees. So the next thing is, at the end of the year, we get all these things that flower at the same time. This is when my heavy nectar flow comes in, and it starts in late August and early September. Maximilian sunflowers, asters, which are a wildflower, goldenrod, heavy nectar flow, ironweed in the wetlands near where we live, and Joe Pye weed. So for me, and look at this, most of these things we don't plant ourselves. I plant, and I'm planting hyssop this year. H-Y-S-S-O-P, I think it's called. So I'm doing an acre of that also. So what you want to do is, you can also go to your local garden center if you're not locked out of it because of COVID-19. But if you can go into your garden center and see what's blooming right now and see what the pollinators are going to, you'll know for your area what the bees are going to want. And if you want to attract a bunch of bees, plant lots of a single source that yields something beneficial to your bees. So that's my lesson on that. Huge concentrations. Get the strongest waggle dancers to lobby for you, and then they will bring those foragers back with them. But four or five flowers of one type of plant and then six or seven of another, that will not get much attention. But there's nothing wrong with little blue orchard bees, mason bees, mining bees, and of course the butterflies that go from flower to flower and practice no constancy. They're social butterflies. So anyway, moving along. Cal Register. Feeder appeared blocked. Oh, this was a discussion about the ceracell style hive top feeder. Let me show you what we're talking about. This is a hive top feeder for a ceracell. This is the 10 frame style. I'm going to take it out of its frame. What happened here was that in this riser, central riser column, which you used to have to put the holes in, which I did, if you look underneath, this is a big cavity. The corners are cavities as well, and the bees can come up and feed through the corners, or they can feed through the central riser. So Kyle was concerned when he took this out to clean everything. There was a whole bunch of honeycomb up in here, and he felt that they were blocking their access to the central feeder here. Now what happens is, and we've looked at this feeder before when they do that, and it's also why I brought this little rabbit around in here today. Look how dirty it is. Well, that's not dirty. That's propolis, and then there's beeswax. See the beeswax underneath? I smashed it. But sometimes you'll even open these and there'll be beeswax, honeycomb, burr comb, coming right up through the center. But what I've always noticed is they leave a little tiny access pathway through here. And this happens most often when you leave these on during wintertime or in the late fall, when the bees are really configuring everything to survive winter. They're closing off all these entrances, but I found that they never completely shut down their access to your sugar syrup, and then of course later to the dry sugar that you put up there as an emergency feed only. So the thing was, and this is part of what we're discussing, if you get little sponge pieces, custom cut them for these corners. This is where some of the people report that the bees get stuck. They fall into the sugar syrup here. But if you pull these out, because I've always said, oh, rough these up. They're already kind of pebbly. And then inside here, this is smooth. And remember what I said about the bees. When these, the way they're set, if your hive is tilted forward, which a lot of people do because they want the rainwater to run out, your syrup in this thing also, this thing holds over 2 gallons of syrup. So the syrup all runs to this end. So then where are your bees? They're up in here trying to get in here. And then what are they doing? They're pushing each other into the syrup. So if you can take pieces of sponge, and you need to sanitize these first, rinse them really well, sanitize them, put that in there, get the sponge wet. And then when you put your entrance over, this is a dry sponge, so it probably won't squeeze in there very well. But when that's in there, and now there's a sponge in that corner, the bees cannot go down and drown in that corner anymore. What they do, let me see if I can get you to see that. If you can look into that corner, you can see that the sponge comes up to the top. The sponge will act as a wick and will pull the sugar syrup up to the top, and guess what? The bees all hover right there, and they put their tongues on the sponge, and they draw everything they need off the sponge without going down inside. So you can actually block their access in those corners, use it as a wick to drop every last ounce of sugar syrup up into the sponge, and then the bees suck it off of the sponge until you can get out there and refill your feeder if you're still keeping that on. So, and then after I asked Kyle, I said, are you sure that it was totally blocked? Did you really check, or did you just cut everything out? He said, no, as an afterthought. He should have probably checked it out. He thinks he may have been worried about that unnecessarily. They may not have actually blocked it. They do like to control everything. So when things have been in there and there's a space that's way bigger than bee space. Bee space is 3/8 of an inch. So if you've got this cavity in there, that's why this cavity too, the bees like to control it. And look what that does. This is also why I say, if they put beeswax on this, leave it, because that's good footing for the bees. Nobody's drowning. But, and we're going to talk about the wraparounds and the testing that I did, although I kind of blew it already because we know we're using sponges. And I'll just tell you right now, if you don't want to watch my feeder fix, we put socks. So many people told me to put socks on these things that we did that. And I bought socks for 8-year-olds just because they're the perfect size. Clip off the little foot part, slide it on there. The sock is the wick. And that works no matter what the configuration is on that center. And guess what? Zero dead bees. This is from Peggy Sells. And hello, Fred. So my hive swarmed back on the 8th. Today is the 20th. And the same hive swarmed again. What is going on? Is this normal? I did catch the first swarm and they are relocated somewhere else. The second swarm is up in a tree. I have some swarm traps out, hoping they will go in. Didn't think they would swarm again so soon. Well, what we're talking about are referred to as after swarms. And this is what you also hear this term, prime swarm. Okay, so prime swarm is what we just got from the woods a couple of days ago. Huge swarm of bees. Now keep in mind who left of the swarm, the old queen, but where did she come from? That queen got her colony through winter and then they swarm out. Now, before they swarm, they are in the resident colony. They're building swarm cells. So there should be a whole bunch of little queen cells there. And before they even get capped, usually the swarm happens and they leave. So these developing virgin queens, when they're capped, they're going to hatch out and there might be 6, 7, or 8 of those in there. So what happens? After this one swarmed out, as soon as the next queen hatches out, guess what she might do? Not just take up residence, she might actually fly out with another swarm. So you can actually, I've had hives swarm 2 or 3 days apart. And so what happens? What are you left with? Well, then you're left with a couple of virgin queens, but guess what else? Who left of the swarm? That might actually be a virgin queen with your swarm. So when she gets hived, there's no guarantee that she's gonna stay. First of all, what keeps the bees around that queen? Their confidence is built by the fact that she has a pheromone release that lets them know that she's fertile and capable of laying. In other words, so she has mated with drones. They also have a sex pheromone that that queen might release when she's not yet mated. And then so she has to fly to a drone congregation area. So they're all in complete risk. They just left that colony with an unmated queen. So you see, sometimes they kind of, they're not totally committed to her and they can pull a fire drill. You know, they get around the queen and they cluster on a tree for a little while and then vroom, they all go right back into the colony. So the best case scenario for them is that the queen get mated before they swarm out. But then another queen hatches and then another one. And then when the hive, when the colony is settled, that's when they'll go around and destroy the remaining queens that are yet to hatch. Or even if one hatches out while there is a current queen in there that is yet to be mated. Keep in mind they don't hatch and fly out and mate right away. So we already know if we're looking at a whole row of queen cells on the bottom and they're all capped and one of them uncaps yesterday and then they swarm tomorrow, she didn't have the time to even get ready to mate. What can she do? Because she's not mated and because she's not full of eggs yet. She can fly. She's lightweight. She's small. She's skinny. And she can take right off and they can fly a long distance. Now, once they set up their new location, then she's going to have to still do those mating flights and she's going to have to become a laying queen. So these after swarms, and who knows why they do it, and this is known by the bee stock that people keep. It's one of the traits that some bee breeders try to avoid having, because if they're labeled swarmy, they could just swarm and swarm and swarm until there's nothing left but a little handful of bees in there that can't sustain themselves. So one of the ways that you can control that, of course, if you can catch that queen. If you know there's still swarm cells in that hive and you can catch the queen that flew out, it's a long shot. But if you can control her and get her back there, here's the problem. She still needs to fly and she still needs to mate. But if you kill her, what happens? Well, all your bees fly back. So this is an opportunity for you to kill every queen cell if you can find it, because they're swarmy. So you've got a colony of bees that they want to swarm even though they've already swarmed, and that's not a good trait for a backyard apiary if you're going to keep them. So what do? You kill all the queen cells, you make sure you got them, because they can blend right into the honeycomb really well. And in the meantime, you fly in a fertile queen. So you get one from a queen breeder that's local, you purchase one through the mail, and within 3 days you install that queen, and now you've got a fertile queen that is laying. So her pheromone is going to ground that group much better than an infertile queen that can really create unrest, because she's a virgin queen. She has not, probably I'm using the word infertile incorrectly, but she has not been mated. So when you have a virgin queen, the pheromone that she puts off is very different from the one that is actually capable of laying eggs, and that will ground your colony better. So they're unstable till they have a fertile queen in there. So those are just different ways to manage it, but you end up with a bunch of swarms until they settle down. Last year, my observation hive colony swarmed 3 or 4 times easily, and I'm sure they also swarmed when I didn't catch them. But for me, that was good news because I could video their interior behavior, the departure, the arrival on a branch, and then, of course, the hiving of the swarm. And they're still doing well. So turned out to be a very good bonus if you can hive them all. But there are people that have bees that ultimately just swarm, and then the very last group just can't sustain themselves, and then they abscond. So because they can't provide. You need enough bees to forage, feed the queen, feed larvae, keep the brood warm, which keeping the brood warm is much easier in the summer months than it is obviously this time of year when we still get cold spells. But so all of these things that will challenge a tiny remnant group, because the prime swarm goes out, there might be 60 or 70% of the bees from that entire colony with them. That thing was huge. The one we just got, it was absolutely huge. Anyway, that's what's going on there. Yeah, and if you get all the capped cells, that's still a virgin queen that flew out with them. So they're kind of doomed unless you can catch them and hive them up, because she has to do mating flights and everything else. And then once she does that, which she may not even be suitable for mating for several days after she's hatched, then she has to fly, get mated, and now what? We're 21 days away, assuming they found a place to start laying their eggs. So again, there's that big taxing of their resources as they have to draw out and build new comb. So there's a lot standing against them. Next one's from Larry Rolla. Installed 2 nukes, 5 frames, on May 1st with new foundation. One hive was clearly stronger than the other from the very start. Now these are nukes, so they're nucleus, which means they have brood. They have brood in all stages, and they have laying queens in them. Since the installation, the strong hive is doing very well and is active on all 9 frames with brood and capped honey on several sides. The other hive has barely built anything on the new foundation. Have not spotted the queen in either hive, but you should know that the queens there are ready because these are fully functioning colonies as they come. That's what a nucleus does. But in the strong one, she's very active, and I have my suspicions that something is wrong in the weak hive. Step one is to find the queen or eggs or larvae so I know she is there. If she is there, I'm thinking about taking a frame of brood from the strong hive and moving it over to the weak hive. Now, these are brand new nucleus colonies, and there are 2 of them, and they're 5 frames each. So a 5-frame nucleus colony should be strong, should be really good and ready to go. But taking brood from one, from a stronger one, when they came from the same source and everything, and you're going to put that in the weaker one, already that's kind of flawed, because we want to know if the weaker colony is not going to sustain itself. Giving them new brood boosts their numbers, but doesn't change the genetics. So if the queen is bad, that's kind of what we need to focus on. You may have to requeen it. Can I leave the nurse bees on the frame when I transfer? Yes, when you're taking, anytime you're doing a split, or if you're fortifying a weaker colony for whatever reason, When you pull up the frame, you make sure capped brood is best, because why? It takes no resources. All they have to do is heat the brood and keep it alive. I've taken brood out and set it down and watched the bees hatch right on a table before, so they're pretty resilient when they're getting near the end. But the other thing is, they're covered with nurse bees that have never been out of the colony. So yes, you can transfer those to the other colony to fortify them. Nurse bees don't get feisty. Some of them can't even put up a good fight yet. They don't sting. Very passive, but you want to make sure that the queen is not on there. So that's the other thing. We don't want to transfer your only queen from this one to that one, obviously. And I'm saying that for the people that are brand new that might not have thought of that. But yes, you can transfer them over. And then through my bee club, a suggestion was to swap the two hives when the foragers are off collecting pollen. So when would they most likely be off collecting pollen? They're going to do that from anywhere from 11 o'clock to about 3 or 4 in the afternoon. That's when most of your foragers are out of the colony. That's also why that's the best time to do your colony inspections. So your bee club suggested swap the hives when the foragers are off. Never heard of that approach before. Is it recommended? I would think the bees in the hive would need another orientation flight since they're already 10 feet from the original spot. Okay, so here's what we have. Two nucleus colonies. There's one here, there's one here. Let's say this is the weak one, this is the strong one. They're only 10 feet apart. Can we take this colony over here, which is the strong one, put it over here, take the weak one, put it where the strong one is, and then hopefully get these foragers to come to that one? I personally, and here's why I don't like answering this question, because somebody at this bee club already said this is what you should do. So I don't like kind of being set up to settle a discussion, but I will tell you what I personally would do and why. If one of the colonies is weak, I would evaluate that weak colony for the queen performance and think about possibly having to replace the queen. If she's not laying enough, if they're not strong enough, if their numbers are dwindling, you may have a problem with the queen. So would that be fixed by taking more bees and installing them with that queen? No, it wouldn't. Okay. So now let's swap the two. Now what do we have? These bees now, when they fly out, foragers from this one will want to go back to this spot over here because that's where they physically were located. What's going to happen when they land there? It's a foreign hive. What's going to happen when they land at the foreign hive? The guard bees are going to engage them on the landing board. Now there's fighting. And the bees that were here that have been moved over here, when they're coming back, all these foragers are coming back, they're going to land here because it's a physical spot that they're supposed to live in, but now they find it's a foreign hive, they're landing, they meet guard bees, now there's fighting. So will they just reinforce that? So we're going to be bleeding off workers from this hive in its new location because they're going to want to go back to the old location. We're going to be bleeding off bees from this one, they're going to go back to that location. They're not necessarily paying attention. And like you said, well, they do orientation flights. So I'm going to tell you about that too. But if you change nothing on their landing boards and all you do is physically change the locations, if these hives look at all alike, they're coming back to their position, not because it's the hive that smells right. So they're coming back. So we're going to create a conflict there, number one. Plus, we're not fixing our genetic problem with the bees. Okay. So if there's a weak colony, we need to find out what the source and reasoning for that weakness is. So if we change those positions and we want the bees departing those hives to do orientation flights and treat it like a new location, you need to do something to change the configuration of that entrance. So you need to put a robbing screen on it and make them go exit a different way than the other. So the other part is, I kind of disagree with the idea of doing it in the middle of the day when they're all out foraging, because that surprises them all, that catches them off guard. When you would really swap these hives in their physical location, when they're only 10 feet apart, so it's a very difficult thing to do anyway, is you do it at night when they're all in, and then you change the physical configuration of their entrance. That means you could change it to an upper entrance because you're trying to find out how you can get these bees to work differently in another location. To me, it doesn't work. They do orientation flights again. If they fly out in the morning, they find out their hive landing board configuration is different. They don't recognize that. They start doing their loops and their figure eights, and they look everything over before they fly off. So I would not swap hives hoping to harvest strong bees from the strong colony into that weak hive voluntarily. We have a conflict. They don't smell right. They're not from the right queen. So I would focus exclusively on the weak hive in diagnosing whether it's the queen's laying pattern is bad. Like you said, we have to look to see if she's got eggs and larvae. What states of development are they? What's the pattern like? But if just their numbers are down and the queen's laying a good pattern and everything else, you could boost them with, you know, a frame of larvae like you want to do. But I don't like a lot of this juxtaposing of hives and physical positions and stuff. Keep them where they are. Evaluate the queen. If your queen's weak, replace the queen. That's my suggestion. Because, yeah, we need to find out what's up. If it's just a matter of numbers, then yes, adding a couple broods, brood frames in that hive with nurse bees will help fortify them, and that frees up more workers in the hive to go out and forage. But and the strong colony, if it's doing really well, will handle that without a problem, and then make sure to push the remaining brood frames together and your new frames outboard of those also. Okay, hope that answered that. Grant Davis, I had my first hive failure this week in the middle of spring of all times. They were too deep strong just a couple weeks ago, but now it's just a bunch of robbed out comb. My only clue is that there is a smell in the hive that reminds me of a hamster cage. Are those robo-hamsters or Syrians? So no sign of rodent activity. What could have happened? Did they die or just abscond? Well, this is why, first of all, and this is located in Texas. When it comes to, now I don't know what a hamster smell really is, but anytime a colony smells off, we need to explore it thoroughly. We need to do hive evaluation, which is different than hive inspection. When we inspect a hive, we just want to see this queen right. We want to see if there's larvae, there's eggs, there's everything. They've got, you know, the pattern's good. They've got, you know, enough pollen in there, and then they're starting to build their resources of honey. Their nectar stores are good. So we don't have to see the queen to know, because if she's got eggs in there, she laid those eggs within the last 3 days. So if there's open brood, she's been in there within the last 9 days. If everything that's left there is all capped and stuff, and there are no open brood, then we might have a problem. So we have to look for the queen. So one of the things, the early warning signs that we need to look at, and I do this every single day as I go out right at sunrise and I look at the landing boards of the beehives. Now, sure, early in the morning, they're not doing, some bees are flying out. I don't know what they're doing because everything is soaking wet from the dew and so on. But it does show me if a hive is doing hygienic behaviors, if they're starting to drag out, developing larvae and things like that. If pupae are laying on the landing board, then I really have to get in and inspect that colony to find out if they're dealing with a varroa load or something. So, and then later in the day. So these are easy, non-invasive things to do. So now we said that they're going to be flying out from 11, you know, to noon on. So go out there at 1 in the afternoon, 2 in the afternoon, and see what the pollen loads are like coming in. If you hive's got pollen coming in, that hive's got pollen coming in, they're doing good. Uh-oh. There's not much pollen coming into this hive. So now we have to do an inspection. So you do your cursory inspection first, and if you find that things are actually queen right inside, that everything looks good, then you close it right back up. But if you don't see the eggs and stuff, now we're into an evaluation. Every single frame's going to get looked at. You have to look for disease. You have to look for problems with the brood. You have to look for the complete absence of the queen. Because here's the thing. One of the reasons that bees will abscond from a hive, absolutely, totally depart from it. Because bees without a queen will still occupy the hive, and then 2.5-3 weeks in, you'll end up with a laying worker that as a ditch effort is trying to reproduce by laying eggs that hatch out as drones. They're just trying to, as they're dying out, send out their genetics into the world. So we have actually a long time to evaluate a colony to find out what's going on, but when they totally abscond, we need to really look at it, because what's going to happen next is robbing. Robbing behavior is very dangerous if you haven't looked into it to find out if you might even have foul brood or something. Because all of these robbing bees, because listen to the smell here. This smell of hamsters, do you know why foul brood is called foul brood? Because it smells foul. It's gone bad. You need to really take a close look at the brood frames and be very careful about biosecurity at this point. And by that I mean, Wear surgical gloves. The tools that you use, use only in this hive while you're inspecting. Pay close attention to the brood to see if there's any signs of illness, sickness, you know, diseased larvae left behind. The bees may have found that they were infected so badly that they just took off. Now, they can actually do this too when there's a high varroa load even. But the beekeeper, with conditions like this, partnered with a smell that's very unfamiliar, this requires a full evaluation of every single frame in the hive. And be prepared to bag and isolate components of the hive if you suspect that you have found. Ooh! I didn't even think of this till just now. These kits, every beekeeper should have this in their emergency kit. What is it? This is the foul brood test kit, and this is AFB diagnostic kit. So you can, on the spot, do a test. When you find brood that seems like it's bad, this is very simple. You follow the instructions on the back of this. I have these. I have never personally had foul brood, but if I see evidence of it, if something smells, if the brood is rancid and it looks greasy and sunken in and some of the things are opening, you got black larvae in there and things just don't look healthy, use one of these test kits. Call in a fellow bee inspector. Well, call your bee inspector if you want to. If you get a positive test on that, it's a total lockdown. You want to isolate that hive. Nobody gets in, nobody gets out. You need to shut down that robbing yesterday. So if it's empty, block the entrance right now even. And that goes to anybody else that finds symptoms anywhere similar to this, and you've lost your bees, do a complete evaluation of the hive. So, did they die or just abscond? If they died, they died outside the colony. So, and that's the other thing, collect the bees that are dead. If there's any in there, bag them up. And do a thorough evaluation. Call somebody in on it. I was making a joke about the hamster smell, but now that I really think about it, you can have foul brood. Do an inspection. Call somebody in. Okay. And this is the funnest part of today. And I'm going to ask for your help. Everybody that's watching this. And I can't endorse this app, but I got a message today from Richard Crystal. It says, have you tried this Varroa Find app? Looks like a great use of technology if it works as it says, and it's free. So here's the thing. Usually when I get an email like that, I just ignore it. I say, Varroa app. That's like, what a joke. Anyway, but it's called Bee Scanning, and the website is beescanning.com. So I thought, you know what? I'm going to look into this, and I downloaded the app on my phone, because last year at this time, I didn't even have a cell phone. So now I do. But anyway, you get to this Bee Scanning app, and you download it to your phone, and you use your telephone number. And so what I do, I look up the app and I see a bunch of gripes and complaints about it. This app only has a rating of 3.0 or something like that on the app list. And so then I read the reviews on here and people are saying stuff like, could not load the app, never got my code. So they give it a 1-star review because they couldn't log in. So let me just tell you, because I installed it on my own phone, and I'll tell you what the app does. But anyway, I went to the site, I read up about it, I did the Google search, scam. I looked up scam, doesn't work. I looked up I hate, and then I put in everything. See, I do all the negative checks first, because if somebody's been duped, or if it turns out to be something it shouldn't be, I want to find out ahead of time. So, but no, there's no bad stuff about it. Not only that, I find out that when they were developing this app, and it's been out for over a year, it's just not getting any exposure. And exposure is appropriate. It's a camera app. So anyway, here's how it works. They got grants for this research because the early information was actually pretty good. So I thought, and I went to Facebook this morning, and at Fred's Fine Fowl, so if you want to join us on Facebook, and this is where you can also post results if you use this app. So you go to this thing, beescanning.com. There's also a YouTube, and the YouTube has like, I don't know, 200 views or something. It's very low. And it's just because it's a non-commercial venture. This app is for free. And what they're trying to do is they're crowdsourcing information about the bees. So, Fred, just tell us what it does. Okay, well, I'll tell you. If you watch the YouTube, you take your phone, you take a frame of brood out, and you're going to need a rack to support your brood frame so it can be held, or use a friend that will hold it very steady for you. Then you take your phone out and you photograph four quarters of the frame. Click, 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 click. And there's very detailed instructions also in the app, so it's pretty cool. And what you do is then you register with your phone number. They give you a code that you punch in that creates an account. Now, of course, every picture that you take of your bees with your phone becomes part of their research, so that even if you delete the app later, your bee pictures get to be used by them. And I think that's perfectly fine. Why would you expect them to harvest out all these pictures, which are going to help them accumulate data and improve the app? So what's the app do? You photograph your brood frames, you get four pictures, flip your brood frame around, four pictures again, and I think there's a distance of, it looks like they shoot them from maybe 10 inches. And then you send in the four pictures, but the cool part is too, in the app, it has you identify your apiary, so mine is the way to be, and then you put in each hive number. So if you've got four hives, the purple hive, the red hive, however you want to name them. And then so what you do is you take the four pictures and then you send them into the company, and the pictures are scanned for evidence of varroa, for evidence of deformed wing virus, and things like that. And then it comes back to you with an analyzed picture. So you get your own pictures back and you look at them and it identifies specific bees that have varroa destructor mites on their thorax and so on. Or this one's got deformed wing virus and things like that. So then when you look at that, now you know that you have, because by the way, I didn't see false positives in the people that were doing it. I'm sure it misses some varroa. But here's the thing, I find that most beekeepers, this is no slam on you, most beekeepers don't get the time or don't take the time to do a sugar roll, and they don't do an alcohol wash. Does this app take the place of sugar rolls and alcohol wash as a method for counting varroa destructor mites? No, it doesn't. It can't be that accurate. Or could it? I don't know. But here's the problem. So that's why I want to get more feedback. I'm going to be using it starting today. I just loaded it today. I'm going to be using it. I'm going to be photographing my own frames, and I'm going to submit those, and I'm going to post those on my Facebook page. And so I'm asking those who also are comfortable using apps that are free, that want to help try this out. And of course, we're contributing to their database by submitting our pictures. And they already have improved their app, but they've been given grants, they've gotten awards, and nobody's talking about this at all. Of course, it's not in the United States, it's in another country. So when you first get into it, you have to go scroll down, pick out your country's flag, click on that, and then of course, you're going to get it in your language. And that's when you type in your cell phone number, and then you get a six-digit number back from them that you put in, and then now you have the account. So, and again, there were a bunch of five-star reviews on the app. You could look at them yourself. Again, I don't know these people, I have nothing to do with these people. The first I heard about it was when Richard brought it to my attention, and my initial thought was to discard it and ignore it because why do I need another app on my phone? But when I find out it has an algorithm that scans the bees for any anomaly with individual bees, and then it identifies that and gives it back to you. So now we know. So if you're not going to do any kind of varroa testing at all, if you're not going to do varroa counts, and you're just one of those people that treats like crazy, try this out and give me feedback and post your pictures, the pictures that they send you back. I don't want to see the pictures that you took because now we just get a million pictures of people's bees on their frames. But again, it's a brood frame, so you take four pictures on each side, so it's in 25% quadrants. They compile that together, and they also have detailed instructions on how to do it. The guy that does a demonstration on the YouTube has a jig that he puts his phone in, and then it slides to this position. He takes a shot, this position takes a shot, puts it on the jig down here. That's more elaborate than you probably need to do. So anyway, in closing, I wanted to share about that app. Bee Scanning, BEESCANNING.com. When you go to their YouTube, I'm the only person that's commented on it. They only have like 2 thumbs up. They don't have any thumbs down though. I have a lot of thumbs down. They don't even have thumbs down. So let me know what you think. And by the way, if you know, is it bad? Is it garbage? Share that. Put it down in the video description. Those of you who have experience with it, try it out. Share your pictures. I'm dying to see what's going on. If I find something cool, I'm going to share about it. So that's it. If you have a question that you want me to consider for next Friday's frequently asked questions, please put that down in the comment section below. You can also follow the link that is in the video description that takes you to the Way to Be page on my main website. And there's a form there. So if you don't want to ask your picture, ask your question in front of everybody, you can fill out the form and submit it as a website visitor feedback kind of thing. So that's it. I think that's all we have going on. Click a thumbs up on this video down here in the corner so that you know that you've already seen it. If you're trying to wade through all 63 of these question and answer videos, that will help you not have to duplicate them. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a fantastic weekend. Don't forget to plant your plants right now.